Good morning, everybody, and can I welcome you to the 26th meeting of the Education and Culture Committee in 2015. Can I remind everybody to make sure that all electronic devices are switched off at all times. We have apologies from Liam MacArthur. Thanks once again to Logan there. That's a personal message from Mr. MacArthur. And can I also welcome Liz Smith, who's joined us for this evidence session. Welcome, Liz. Our first item is to decide to take item 5 in private. Are members agreed?
Agreed,
thank you. Our next item is our final evidence session on the Higher Education Governance Scotland Bill. Can I welcome Angela Constance, Cabinet Secretary for Education and Lifelong Learning, and also her accompanying officials. Good morning to all of you. Can I go straight to the statement, I think, from the Cabinet Secretary, who wants to make a few remarks.
Good morning, Convener, and good morning, colleagues. Very happy to appear before committee this morning to discuss the Higher Education Governance Bill. The Scottish Government, Convener, values our higher education institutions, and because of the faith that we have in them and in terms of what they deliver, as a government we are again investing over £1 billion this year in the sector. In a nutshell, the Scottish Government wants this bill to enable governance that is more modern, inclusive and transparent, informed by the recommendations in the 2012 review of good higher education governance in Scotland. We are of the view that elected chairs, modernised governing bodies and academic boards, and enhancement of the definition of academic freedom can help deliver that vision. I want to reassure you that I have listened and continue to listen to the views of committee and indeed the views of all stakeholders on this bill. And we are also scrutinising the substantial amount of evidence presented to this committee and other committees considering the bill. Before I go on to talk about some of the provisions in the bill, I would like to restate some points that I have made in Parliament a few weeks ago. Firstly, the Scottish Government does not seek to advance ministerial control of our institutions. Secondly, we are of the view that the bill does not add to any existing risk of reclassification of Scottish higher education institutions as public sector bodies by the Office for National Statistics. And I have written to the Finance Committee to that effect. Thirdly, further reclassification is an outcome that the Scottish Government would never want to realise. And finally, the Scottish Government has no intention of abolishing the post of rector. Now, turning to some key areas of provision in the bill, I want to be very clear that this government supports the principle of elected chairs for higher education governing bodies. In terms of how elected chairs will work in practice, I remain open-minded at this stage and welcome any and all good ideas that can help us arrive at the best model for good modern governance. My overarching aim is to ensure that access to the position of elected chair is available to the widest pool of suitably qualified and skilled people as possible. We've already started talking to all stakeholders on a model of elected chairs over the summer. This active dialogue continues. The Scottish Government would be happy to keep committee updated on these discussions. My aim is, where possible, to reach consensus through a continued dialogue with stakeholders. I hope that we might be able to co-produce solutions to some of the issues that the earlier consultation has shown carried a range of views, rather than simply lay down the government's position. But generally, as we begin to plan for stage two of the bill's parliamentary consideration, we continue to examine all of the constructive ideas and suggestions put to us by relevant committees of this Parliament and stakeholders. And as I've already indicated to Parliament Convener, I am open-minded about amendments and willing to examine further, for example, sections 8 and 13 of the bill, and delighted to take any questions.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. We'll just go straight to questions from members, and can I begin with Chick Brody?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary.
I wonder why it's very encouraging that after our earlier debate on this that you're trying to reach consensus with stakeholders. I wonder if I can ask how many principals of universities and not necessarily leaders of trade unions you and your officials have met with prior to reaching this stage.
Well, I obviously have an ongoing engagement with the higher education sector. Yeah, with specific regards to the bill. I've certainly been party to two roundtable discussions. In between those roundtable discussions, I have met with other individuals, including current and former rectors, and my officials have carried out a range of engagements with a variety of stakeholders, whether that's principals, whether it's representatives from trade unions or students' organisations, that engagement is ongoing with regards to myself and my officials.
Okay, thank you. I wonder then if I may ask, in terms of looking at the policy memorandum and all of the documents that we've all received, how does this bill improve governance? I mean, what deficiencies in governance of the universities and higher education has there been in the past? Can you give us some examples?
I mean, the premise that I'm starting from, Mr. Brodie, is that it's not from the premise of deficit. I am not for 1 minute saying that governance in our university sector is poor. But I do believe that governance can be better, and based on the evidence of the von Pruszynski review in 2012, there was a range of evidence gathered, some of it articulating the concerns of some stakeholders. I know that committee has heard from NUS Scotland and the UCU, and I think the UCU put it quite well when they spoke of that lack of connectivity that can sometimes exist in any institution between staff, trade union members and management. And, but I repeat, for me this is about continuous improvement. I think, are quite right to expect the highest standards of governance. Our universities overall are excellent, and in return for £1 billion worth of investment that this government has continued to invest every year, I think we're quite right to expect the very highest standards of governance. And this bill, is making proposals in some discrete areas that I and the government believe will lead to improvements. And this is about, how can we continue to evolve university governance to the very highest of standards to ensure that all voices in the university community are heard.
I understand that, and but you've just made the point yourself that our universities are excellent and of the highest standard, I think, were the words that you used. That's why I'm struggling with what needs to be improved. I know you've talked to the UCU. How many of the principals have you talked to?
I would have to go away and, I suppose, add that up, if you like, Mr. Brodie. But, I mean, I have probably met most principals in Scotland, either in the context or specifically of the bill or in the broader engagement that we have as a government.
The reason I ask about deficiencies in the past and why we're doing this, surely if we are to change the system, we need to know what needs to be improved. That's why I asked the question about deficiencies. So if we are excellent and we know where we sit in the top 200 universities in the world, I can understand more democratisation, which we support, but there are some very fundamental proposals here which forgive me, which might be challenged. I mean, what happens? Just let's see. Let's play the devil's advocate. What happens if there's no improvement, or worse still, there's a diminution of performance? How do we recover that?
Well, I I think, thinking about the first part of your question, Mr. Brodie, just because an institution is good does not mean that they cannot continue to evolve. It doesn't mean that they cannot continue to improve their governance. I think we are right to expect, bearing in mind that our universities are good and world-leading, that for them to be exemplars in governance. There was a body of work completed in 2012, led by Professor Vaughan Prusinski. The bill aims to reflect the evidence gathered in that review and to implement the recommendations in that review, particularly as some of the recommendations have not been followed through in the sector's code of good governance. And I suppose, you know, ultimately, you know, what we are striving for is a greater participation in decision-making from within the institution. And I fail to see how that can be a negative and how that cannot take any institution or indeed the sector forward. We know that, you know, good governance, in essence, you know, has to include, you know, a range of skills, a diversity of people, and that, you know, where you have an organisation or an institution that includes, you know, all the voices, all the interest, surely that enriches, you know, the transparency and the accountability, and actually at a very fundamental level enriches the decision-making process.
Well, I accept your participation in decision-making is, and as I mentioned, more democratisation is fine, but at the end of the day, somebody has to make decisions, and we'll come to that later. So, but on the basis that we can't define what deficiencies there have been, how do you propose to measure outcomes that will indicate that we are improving?
Well, I think some stakeholders have defined what some of those deficiencies have been, and certainly the Vaughan Prusinski review, you know, gathered a range of evidence and views, you know, from different stakeholders regarding concerns. In terms of how you monitor how the Prusinski review, as articulated in the legislation, how that is actually implemented and the impact that that has, you know, we would want to do that, you know, working hand in glove with all the stakeholders and with the sector as a whole. There is the University Sector Advisory Board, which is currently reviewing its function. That board, you know, could, you know, have a renewed focus on governance and monitoring impact and measuring success and progress.
Take just one measure that indicates a university, because of the change in governance, will be more measured and monitored for improvement.
Yeah, I mean, it is more of a qualitative process than a quantitative binary process. So again, in terms of any measurement, we would want to come to an agreement with the stakeholders about the best way to measure progress, as opposed to government, you know, forming a view about how we, you know, measure progress. We wouldn't. What I'm saying is, we wouldn't want to do that in splendid isolation.
No, I understand that, but it'd be unusual not to have some quantitative measures of outcome improvement. But thank you.
I mean, there could be an outcome improvement plan.
Okay, thank you. Mary Scanlon.
Thank you. And can I also say that I was very pleased to hear in the debate that where there was scope to alleviate concerns, the government would listen. I think on our side, we would certainly welcome that. Can I just say that this bill has certainly, it may be meeting with some delight from Professor von Prusinski, but no one else in the university sector seems to think that it's hugely beneficial. So could I just follow the points that Chick Brodie was making? When Chick asked about what deficiencies there are, the bill has been described as a solution looking for a problem. Your response was the lack of connectivity that can sometimes exist. It does seem a bit nebulous to bring forward a huge piece of legislation for something that may sometimes exist. So can I first of all ask, what about the good review of good higher education governance code? Because it seems to me that that is an excellent partnership between the government and the universities. It seems to me that progress is being made. It's a good example of the government working together with universities rather than being on a collision course. And also, my understanding is that a huge amount of progress has been made in the process of implementing that code. And for example, in the past year, 42% of those who have been appointed to boards have been women. So, you know, why bring forward legislation when the code of higher education governance does appear to be working more constructively than this legislation is?
I think the first point I would make to Mrs. Scanlon is that there is a wider university community that is broader than principals and managers of the sector. In my experience of my engagement with a range of stakeholders, including principals and chairs of court, is that yes, there are people that are opposed to the bill in its entirety, but there are many shades of opinions out there. And, you know, I repeat, convener, as a government, we will work hard to build consensus whenever and wherever that is possible. Mrs. Scanlon is right to say that progress has been made with the code. I would never demur from that. Of course, not all aspects of the von Pronsinsky review are reflected in the code. And of course, the von Pronsinsky review did look at a range of evidence from Scotland, UK, Europe and beyond in terms of issues in and around governance. But I suppose what we have to ask ourselves is how do we ensure that progress is ongoing for the future and how it is anchored for the future. And although this bill is discreet in its elements and the changes that it seeks to make, it is very much about ensuring that governance can evolve to the highest of standards to ensure that our sector is indeed operating to the very highest of standards that we would expect in 21st century Scotland.
I mean, many of our universities have been around for over 600 years. I think we're all justly proud of Scotland's universities that rank in the best in the world. You will have seen the evidence from people like David Ross and Jocelyn Bell. You know, these are academics that, as parliamentarians, we cannot ignore. And they are concerned about this bill's impact on the government governance of our universities and the reputation of our universities, both here and abroad. So when you talk about future-proofing, you know, I cannot understand. I think we're all still struggling for the question that Chick Brodie asked. You know, is this going to be beneficial? Which of the identified problems will be addressed? And if the bill does pass, and with SNP majority, it's probably likely to, where's the measures, or where are the improvements, or where are the benefits in future? And as a member of the Audit Committee, we're also looking at things like remuneration committees. So, I mean, the bill is very silent on, you know, taking forward the work on behalf of the governing body, you know. And I think if there, just finally, convener, if there was no progress at all, and if the universities were not engaging with government, I would actually almost see that there was a justification for this bill. But what we're looking at is tremendous progress being made over the years, a good working relationship, and that is actually being damaged by what is called a punitive, unnecessary and counterproductive bill. You know, so I think we're all struggling to understand why this heavy-handed legislation is necessary when there is good work ongoing across the sector with a constant annual review of governance ongoing.
I suppose I would question the premise that says we're good, so leave us alone, there's no room for further improvement. I mean, the whole essence about striving for the highest of standards, about striving for excellence, is the notion of continuous improvement. And what, you know, I'm seeing on behalf of the government is not that universities are starting from a poor base, far, far from it, but there is room for improvement, and surely that's in keeping with the very highest of standards. And yes, we acknowledge the progress that has been made by the code, but you know, for example, I mean, the code was devised and pulled together by senior people in the sector, and didn't, in its genesis, include students, staff, or trade unionists. So I suppose I would, you know, question that aspect of the culture, and surely, you know, all the stakeholders, you know, working together in, you know, social partnership, surely, you know, that should be the norm. And, you know, this is a discrete bill, you know, with some discrete measures. You know, it's certainly not, you know, looking at overhauling, you know, all aspects of university governance. And, you know, Mrs. Scanlon is right. I mean, as parliamentarians, we do indeed listen to all views, and the views of eminent academics like the people that Mrs. Scanlon has mentioned. But we have a responsibility to listen to, you know, other academics. And I certainly get correspondence from a range of academics. They may not be as high profile as Jocelyn Bell or Mr. Ross, but there's a range of views out there in the academic community. And as parliamentarians, you know, we do indeed have a responsibility to listen, but to listen to all stakeholders. And, you know, bearing in mind that we've still to reach a stage one report, I've already indicated to Mr. Brodie that, you know, we can, in collaboration with all parts of the sector, you know, look at what would be a meaningful way to measure progress. And in terms of remuneration, you know, the newly reformed or constituted, you know, university core, you know, will, you know, I suppose we'd be looking at remuneration through that prism of more diverse voices around the table of the governing body who will be making decisions
Just to make a final point, it was just that, convener, this committee was very careful in inviting along academics to our round table session. We took a wide range from the Conservatoire to University of Edinburgh, small, large universities. And not one academic round the table was in favour of this bill.
I'm not disputing the process that committee has went through in terms of...
Well, I'm looking, you know, for the evidence.
Yeah, well, I mean, up in my office, Mrs. Scanlon, I have hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of postcards from members of the UCU, you know, calling on the government, you know, to enact this bill. I think it is fair to acknowledge, as I do, that there are a range of views, and there are a range of views from within the academic community also.
Thank you very much. Gordon, did you have a question on this?
A very quick question on a specific point. I met with one of the universities last week, and they raised the question about elected student representatives. I'm just looking for some clarification. I was informed that the way that legislation reads at the moment, then elected student representatives, i.e. president and vice president, who are on sabbatical, are not eligible to serve on the university court because technically they aren't students. Is that a correct understanding of the bill? And if it is it something you're intending to address to remove that anomaly?
That most certainly not would be our intention, given that all the policy documents, when talking about student representation on the governing body, one of them is to be, you know, the president of the Students Association, and you know, one of the two student members is to be a woman. But we'll go back and examine that carefully. But that would not be our intention. And if there is some sort of unintended consequences in terms of how matters are drafted, we will indeed, okay, you know, rectify that.
Okay, thanks so much.
Can we move on now to ONS reclassification? And Gordon, I think it's you again.
Thanks very much, convener. I wanted to ask you about the potential risk of ONS reclassification. And I know you said in your opening remarks that you do not seek to advance ministerial control and therefore, you know, bring that into being. So is there anything in your view in the bill that requires autonomous institutions to ask government for permission to conduct their business?
No, there's not.
Right. So how confident are you that the provisions in the bill are compliant with what the current indicators of government control set out within the ONS existing classification?
Well, considerations regarding ONS reclassification have been absolutely central to the work that has went on around this bill. And, you know, we've considered the issue of ONS reclassification, you know, prior to the actual introduction of the bill. I was asked to provide to the Finance Committee a summary of our work on this matter, and that letter to Finance Committee shows the consideration that the government has given to each of the indicators of government control. We've looked closely at the European System of Accounts, that's the ESA guidance 2010. That guidance has, you know, various indicators of government control. We've went through all of those indicators, and you know, we're confident that the bill is compliant with the indicators as laid out in that guidance.
And in terms of the issue of Scottish ministers' powers to make regulations, can you say something about what does future-proofing mean? And in past experience, how often are there likely to be changes required to governing body and academic board compositions?
I mean, in terms of future-proofing, in essence, you know, the intent behind that is that where there are, you know, modest changes required, you know, perhaps at the bequest of the sector, that there is a mechanism to do that without requiring primary legislation. I've already indicated, you know, to Parliament in the debate a few weeks ago that, you know, a willingness to go and look again at what exactly is and isn't required in terms of achieving, you know, the purpose of the bill. These sections, you know, are routine. You know, most legislation, you know, will have some facility to, you know, amend the legislation in the future. But these provisions, I mean, they're not there to make, you know, radical changes to the legislation. In terms of how often ministers have had to return to Parliament to make use of these types of provision, I'm certain it's not something that I've been required to do as a minister as yet, but maybe officials could perhaps maybe give an overview of their knowledge as to when that's occurred in the past.
I think it's quite difficult to generalise, because in each piece of legislation the provisions might be used more, and some in others almost never. I mean, in looking at other pieces of legislation that apply to the further and higher education sector, so there's the 2005 Act and the 1992 Act, and for example, in the 1992 Act, there were powers in relation to changing the composition of college boards and changing the the provisions in that, those powers were never used. They were amended in 2013, but prior to that, they hadn't been used to change the composition of the boards or the constitution of colleges. So it is quite difficult to give any kind of general answer. I think the other point is worth making, though, is generally these kind of powers would not be used to make radical amendments that go against the grain of the original legislation, because there then becomes a question of whether that kind of amendment is actually within the power, and we would hesitate to use the powers in those ways because it's unlikely to be within the power to just completely do the opposite of what the existing legislation says.
And my final point is, again, in your opening remarks, you said you never want to realise a situation where ONS reclassification takes place. However, if the ONS themselves identify that classification is a real possibility, what steps can be taken by the government to ensure that that doesn't happen?
Okay, and I'll ask officials to talk through that process from a more technical standpoint. I mean, obviously the premise of my argument as a minister is that there is nothing in this bill that increases the risk of ONS reclassification. And as I said earlier, you know, that is something as a government that we would always seek to avoid, because ONS reclassification, while it wouldn't happen overnight if it occurred, and I don't accept that it would occur as a result of this bill, it wouldn't happen overnight, but it would, if it were to happen, there would be, implications flowing from that. And we do have a kind of broader relationship engagement with ONS as well. Do you want to say something about the more kind of technical aspects, Stephen?
Well, I think perhaps a legal colleague might have a perspective, but from a policy point of view, the Cabinet Secretary's already covered it. I mean, if there's no intention at all to have a reclassification event happen, so would immediately set in train a process of considering how to remove the legislation or not implement or commence those parts of it which had been cited. But in terms of the technical, the operational moves behind that, perhaps my colleague Ailsa may have a perspective.
Yeah, in terms of what happened in England with the reclassification of colleges, then the government was able to then bring forward legislation to reverse the reclassification, and there would be time given to implement any reclassification decision, in which case there could be legislation to ensure in Scotland that the universities were not then reclassified, and that would involve some kind of a dialogue with ONS to work out where the issues were and what their concerns were in relation to the governmental controls that they saw were leading to reclassification, and then the whole suite of legislation applying to universities would have to be considered, and it wouldn't just be this bill, it would be the existing legislation that applies as well.
Okay, thanks so much.
Mark Griffin.
Thanks. Morning, Cabinet Secretary. Just firstly ask, you've said this morning in the chamber that you don't think this bill presents any risk of reclassification, but previously we've heard officials say that they believe there to be a risk, albeit a low risk. Can I ask, has there been any work, any legal advice taken by the government that has resulted in this change of rhetoric or change of stance that previously been a low risk of reclassification, there is now no risk?
I think what I said, Mr. Griffin, is that there is no increased risk or additional risk as a result of this bill, and officials can speak to the kind of ongoing issues in and around ONS reclassification, but I just wanted to stress there's no change in rhetoric here at all.
Yes, okay, it just seems to be, I mean, previously obviously we've heard from officials that there was a low risk of reclassification as a result of the bill, so there does seem to be a change in rhetoric, but if that can be clarified, then that would be helpful, I think.
I think that myself and other colleagues that were here, I think probably the Finance Committee was the committee where that dialogue might have been had. We would go back and look at the record, but I think that there exists a risk which could be assessed without the bill in terms of, and I think that someone may mention the Anderson Strathairn advice that University of Scotland have sought. They, in their own way of looking at it, map out a lot of the current features of the system which could be seen as part of a risk assessment. So you couldn't say at the moment there is absolutely no risk that reclassification would be considered without this bill. The question of this bill having an additional risk is something that's the government's opinion. It does not advance that risk. But if there's any inconsistency between what I'm saying now and what was said in the Finance Committee transcript, we'll examine both and get back to committee on that.
Okay, thank you. The question I had was the review of higher education status by the ONS. It's been publicised that covers English and Welsh institutions. Just to ask the Cabinet Secretary if the ONS have been in touch to clarify at all whether that would be that review under existing provisions will cover Scottish higher education institutions at all.
No, I'm not aware of the ONS being in touch with the Scottish Government with regards to that, but I mean, Sharon, you may want to speak about our broader relationship with the ONS.
They certainly haven't been in touch with us around classifications of the classification work that they're doing next year with regards to English and Welsh institutions.
Okay. University of Scotland had written to yourself, Cabinet Secretary, on the 29th of October. Have you had any time to respond to the comments in that letter?
We're currently working through that response, but I mean, I have received the letter and I have seen it.
Okay. Some of the comments in that letter, I think it's fair to say, criticise the government's approach. One of the lines from that letter is, the Scottish Government risk assessment in relation to ONS reclassification appears from the content of the letter from yourself of the 5th of October to this convener of the Finance Committee to have completely overlooked the five specific indicators of control for non-profit institutions such as HEIs contained in paragraph 2.39 of ESA 2010. I know you're saying you're working through that letter, but are you able to comment on that particular criticism?
I mean, in broad terms, I mean, officials have considered very carefully and closely all the guidance that is produced by ONS and the Treasury on the matter. As I said, Mr. Griffin, we are closely looking at the detail of the University of Scotland's latest letter, and of course we'll respond in detail by reply to the very specific points, and obviously that information will be shared with the committee.
Thank you. John Pentland.
Cabinet Secretary, or Stephen, I think you said earlier there that, just for clarity, there was no risk, potential risk, minimal risk of reclassification. And in a letter to the Finance Committee, you gave a summarised analysis as to what that is. Is it possible for that analysis to be published and to be given to the committee, along with perhaps any legal advice given?
Yeah, I mean, it's always a desire of the government to be as helpful and forthcoming as possible. The Finance Committee had initially asked for a summary of our work. They have asked the government for further information prior to the Stage 1 vote. And, there's an opportunity there, given that we have received some very detailed remarks from University Scotland and other stakeholders to include some of the broader issues and some of the concerns raised by University Scotland in a future response to the Finance Committee, which of course we'll share with this committee.
Liz Smith.
Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. I wonder, could you confirm that Section 8 in the bill allows ministers to modify the categories of membership of governing bodies and the number of persons to be appointed?
Yes.
Thank you for that. Could you also confirm that the government did not take any consultation on these sections of the bill?
The government, yes, I mean, that's correct. I mean, the government consulted on proposals for legislation in terms of the sections that relate to regulation and enabling powers. They were included in the bill that was published, obviously part of a stage one process allows scrutiny and feedback with regards to those provisions. But you know, the government consulted on policy as opposed to a bill in draft.
Could I just probe further on that point? Could you explain the difference between your own comments in the chamber on the 28th of October and also again repeated this morning, when you say that you are absolutely crystal clear that the Scottish Government does not seek to advance ministerial control over our HEIs, and the comments that were made by officials on the 6th of October to this committee, I have the transcript here, who confirmed to this committee that the bill was adding powers for ministers. That's a contradiction.
But the bill does not seek to give ministers any new powers over the appointment of chairs or the actual appointment of members to you know, the governing body or various committees. We don't have any powers.
Cabinet
to
Secretary, it's not about the names of the people. It's about the actual powers that would exist. And your officials on the 6th of October confirmed that the bill was increasing that power. Now, because of that, that's the concern about the potential for ONS reclassification, because, as you know from the comments that you made before, there are certain criteria about that ONS possible reclassification that if this Section 8 of the bill is increasing ministerial power, by definition, that means that ONS would have to look at that in the light of possibly reclassifying them as public bodies. Would you accept that that's the reason for the concern and the reason for the letter that University of Scotland has sent back to you, because they feel that government hasn't taken evidence on this?
I mean, the concerns articulated by University of Scotland and others are not concerns that I share. Nonetheless, there is a willingness on my behalf and on behalf of the government to look in detail at those concerns and a willingness to attempt to remove the concerns articulated by others. What the bill seeks to do is to provide a framework for governance, and I also think it's worth bearing in mind that, you know, membership of Court for Ancient Universities is set out in legislation, you know, legislation going back, you know, to 1966. So we're not seeking to do anything that's out of the ordinary or unusual. I don't know, do you want to add anything, Stephen, from a policy perspective? Or?
Yeah, I mean, perhaps some of my own comments are in that transcript. I think on the point of, and I think it came up during that session, that the indicators of control and the guidance talk about and very clearly focus on the appointment, removal, approval of individuals. That's a slightly different point to whether there's a power. I mean, obviously Section 8 is a power. It's literally in a bill as a power. But it's whether that power advances control. And it's about process. It's the how and not the who. But in terms of parts of the transcript, the idea that it is a power and it provides something new to Scottish ministers can't be denied.
A point, Mr White, the Cabinet Secretary has just confirmed that the Scottish Government did not take any consultation on sections 8 and 13 on the bill. And at the same time, you're arguing that you don't accept the concerns of University Scotland. I'm not sure how you do not accept these concerns if you don't have the evidence to be able to rebut them, because the University of Scotland are extremely clear in the evidence that they have taken. They've gone to a great deal of, and I believe they have consulted with officials, they've gone to a great deal of trouble to ensure that they are well briefed on this. Where is the evidence that you do not accept their concerns?
I suppose the evidence is contained in one place in the Finance Committee letter that the Cabinet Secretary sent, and I think in an earlier answer she said that we would be looking at what the Finance Committee have requested in terms of seeing additional analysis before the Stage 1 debate. So that was the evidence then, and there would be more. In terms of the Section 8 and 13, I think it's been said many times that they are genuinely future-proofing housekeeping. The intention for those sections was very much that. But I respect, of course, what University of Scotland have offered and their evidence and their take on it. They see those sections as substantially more than that. And I think also the Cabinet Secretary has been clear that the government are listening very closely to all evidence presented specifically on those matters. But
I think the other point is that, you know, when it came to the Aberdeen peripheral road, Mr. Swinney took five different pieces of evidence on that for ONS, the possibility of reclassification on that issue. Why is it that the Scottish Government has not done this for a huge issue relating to our universities, which, as many members already said this morning, are our most successful part of the education system? What is the government's answer to why this evidence has not been taken?
And essentially, Convener, I mean, this is an issue in and around statistical classification. I would see it more as that type of issue as opposed to, say, a legal issue. But as, you know, I hope that been clear to committee that officials, you know, have examined this area very carefully in terms of all the guidance that's available from ONS and the Treasury, and, you know, that consideration, you know, includes all, you know, relevant areas of government. You know, it's not just in terms of the, you know, the world of education and government, and, you know, there is consideration using the expertise of other parts of government that have had exposure to this type of issue in other areas. I don't know, Sharon, is there anything you would usefully want to add? I mean, I think it's important to say that, you know, it would not be the norm to consult on routine housekeeping sections in legislation when you're consulting on the policy intent or proposals to be placed in legislation. And, you know, that's the value of, you know, stage one process of Parliament, is that people can scrutinise, you know, the absolute detail of the bill. Sharon, is there anything you want to add?
I think that's right. I think we have learned a lot around this subject over the last year as a result of the work that's been undertaken around the Aberdeen Western Peripheral Route, and that learning has been applied in this circumstance.
Cabinet Secretary, could I finish on one question? When it comes to this bill, all stakeholders, students, staff, academics, business, they're all concerned about the aspect of ministerial control and ONS reclassification, as is the Scottish Government, so it claims. Would it not be sensible to remove sections 8 and 13 from the bill to take out any risk whatsoever?
You know, I mean, that has been actively considered, whether we should look at amendment or removal. And I think I was quite clear in Parliament that, you know, there was an open-minded and careful consideration to that, those very matters.
Thank you. George Adam.
Yes. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. And correct me if I'm misquoting you here, Cabinet Secretary, but you did say in your opening statement you're open-minded about amendments and willing to look at Section 8 and 13. Was that more or less to go down the routes of allaying the fears of some of the sector?
As I've just, at risk of repeating myself...
Sometimes, you know, it's good to say things more than once in this committee.
I've you know, already, you know, made plain... I think that, you know, we will consider either amendment or removal.
Yep. Okay. Thank you very much. Colin Beattie.
Cabinet Secretary, I'd like to look around some of the comments about the appointment of the chair to the governing body. There's several points that have come out of the various discussions that we've had. One is that the universities are quite concerned that there's a clear link between the governing body and the chair, and that there'd be real problems if the chair was appointed and elected by a group other than the governing body. Would you agree with that?
No, I don't think I do. I mean, I think when people are elected to positions or appointed to positions, you know, they have a responsibility based on the job they have been elected or appointed to do. You know, as an MSP, you know, I'm elected by the good people of Almond Valley, but as a minister, I'm subject to the ministerial code and, you know, have to respect the place and rights of Parliament. I hope I've not misunderstood your question, Mr. Beattie, but that's my kind of instinctive response to it.
Maybe on a related matter, who would the electorate for the chair be? Unions and some of the student groups are arguing for a wider electorate. How do you feel about that?
Well, the Scottish Government has had a consistent position that we are in favour of chairs to university courts being elected. And the chair of the university court is, if you like, the senior governor, sometimes called, you know, the vice convener or convener. So we're clear that position should be an elected one. As I said in my opening remarks, that process of election is one that we are still in very close dialogue with stakeholders, both individually and collectively. Mr. Beattie is right to indicate that there are a range of views. On the one hand, some students and trade unions are arguing that the franchise, if you like, should be every member of staff and every student, with no selection process about who is eligible to stand for election. On the other hand, we have other people, you know, within senior management in the sector, arguing that there needs to be a robust selection process and that the electorate should be the reconstituted or the modernised university court. From a government's perspective, I said in my opening remarks, we remain open-minded, but we are committed to the election of chairs, which would, you know, necessitate an election as opposed to an appointment. In terms of some of my own thinking, and, you know, I'm not closing down co-design in the sector of how we do this, but bearing in mind that you're looking to elect the senior governor, for example, I think it is important that individual is able to take up their post, and, you know, that they are not, you know, unable to do so. I mean, sometimes with elections of rectors, for example, you know, a student body, you know, might elect a rector that's not able to chair court. And now that is their right to do that. I'm not questioning that. But in terms of the senior governor, you know, I would be strongly of the view that they need to be able to take up the post of senior governor stroke elected chair.
Another interesting point that was raised is about the actual appointment process and the fact that the anticipation is it would be an open process whereby people would have to put their names forward and go through some sort of selection and sifting. And there was a feeling that this would dissuade some very competent candidates, particularly women, from actually standing.
I think we have to be really careful, Mr. Beattie, about quite lazy assumptions about women in terms of seeking promotion or standing for some sort of public office. I think the reason for women not necessarily putting themselves forward for these positions are quite complex. What the regulations, as it stands, you know, they describe, you know, regulations to enable, you know, an open process that culminates, you know, in an election. As I said, you know, I want to remove any ambiguity, work with the sector, and, you know, co-design what should be put in place of section one in the bill at stage two. But
for example, I'm not preempting where we'll get to with the discussions, but, you know, for example, an open process, you know, could have an obligation to advertise the post in the press. It could also include some sort of, you know, criteria, as I've alluded to, about, you know, an individual being physically available, you know, to take up post. You know, it could, again, I'm not preempting the outcome of the ongoing discussions with the sector, but it could include some sort of, you know, fit and proper persons test. You know, I do want to ensure that, you know, that we're able to consider a wide range of candidates and not have an unduly, you know, narrow focus. But these are, you know, various options that, you know, could be helpful to advertising the position and seeking a broader range of candidates to come forward.
Has the Scottish Government done any assessment on how many additional candidates might be expected to come forward? You were talking about a much wider range presenting than we've got now. Has there been any assessment on that?
I mean, I think there are opportunities potentially in terms of how any process of selection may work in terms of how, you know, positions, you know, are advertised or communicated to the wider world. But I think it'd be very disingenuous of me to sit here and say that, you know, there's a piece of work that the government can do that can, you know, establish actuarially, you know, how many more candidates that we'll elicit by, you know, pursuing a particular process.
Perhaps finally I can just comment on the remuneration of the board chair. There's been some criticism from University of Scotland about the bill's provisions on remuneration, the detail of which is also left to regulation. How does the Scottish Government react to these criticisms in this regard?
I mean, the intent of having in the bill a section on remuneration very much flowed from the von Pronzinski review. It was one of his recommendations in that if you seek a wider range of candidates potentially putting themselves forward, that consideration has to be given to remuneration. So in essence, you know, it's recognising that, you know, given the amount of time that an elected chair, as, you know, current chairs currently invest, you know, a not insubstantial amount of time in the job that they do, that remuneration was not unreasonable and in many ways, according to von Pronzinski, desirable if you're looking for that wide range of people. But as I've said, with regards to other aspects of the bill in relation to regulation, I mean, we'll, you know, look very closely at what's in the bill and whether it's actually required or whether it's expressed in the best possible way.
Just one final quick question. If statute is to provide for remuneration of the chair, should that principle be extended to other members of the governing body or relevant committees?
I think there is a distinction between, you know, other roles and other people involved in the governing body or committees, given that it is a substantial role to chair a university court, because it doesn't just involve chairing. I mean, people may chair the university court, you know, 5-6 times a year, but they will have many other duties as that senior governor with, you know, overall responsibility for good governance. You know, they're responsible for, you know, the performance appraisal of the principal, for example. And in terms of the time that a chair would have to invest, I mean, I think it's probably about a day a week. So I think there is a particular case to be made in and around the remuneration of the chair as opposed to other members of court or committees. But as I said earlier, Mr. Beattie, we'll look to see whether we've got the detail right in the bill with regards to that.
Can I just
clarify, obviously, Cabinet Secretary, the institutions already have the power to remunerate a chair if they so wish. Why? I just want to be clear about why you feel it's necessary to put on the face of the bill or even via regulations that the government will decide on this matter.
Yeah, I mean, the recommendation came from Von Pronsinski, you know, in the context of considering, you know, what was good governance. But I mean, I'm into meeting to committee that I, you know, remain open-minded about it.
Okay, thank you.
But the principle is important that remuneration should be available, whether it needs to be in legislation and whether it's articulated in the right way, I think is another matter.
Okay, thank you. Chick Brody.
Thank you, Convener. On this particular issue of electing a chair, there's already a situation where the director is elected in some cases, in all cases, by the staff and the students and the wider electorate. In the basis of the conversations that you say you've had with principals, wouldn't it be sensible to look at, rather than look at the personalities and the election of a chair, but look at the whole operation of the court and perhaps consider the rector, and this would have to apply to all universities, the rector being the chair of the court for policy matters, and looking at a co-chair appointed by the governing body. In my experience, external chairmen have, you know, or chair persons have a great difficulty unless they can take the governing body with them on decisions. Wouldn't it be appropriate to have the rector change the legislation? The rector is the appointed chair of the court, but there is a co-chair to look at operational issues and oversee the role of the committees. Has that been considered, or will it be considered on the basis that you said, Cabinet Secretary, that you're open to suggestions?
I think I understand what Mr. Brodie's driving at. But we have to be clear, I mean, the role of rector is quite different in parts from that of the senior governor stroke convener. And what we're looking to do is to introduce elected chairs across all 18 institutions. They exist just now where rectors currently exist, or where rectors exist for the ancient universities. Because rectors at the University of Highlands and Islands and Dundee don't have a statutory right to chair court, but rectors do in the ancient universities. And as I've, you know, indicated consistently, the government believes there is a value in having an elected chair in all institutions. But I do stress that, you know, the role of rector is quite different from that of senior governor. I mean, a rector is ambassadorial, has a huge value in terms of raising the profile of the sector. They indeed can be representative of, you know, the views of staff and students, certainly in Edinburgh. Other ancient rectors are just elected by students. You know, they can indeed be a point of contact for staff and students, and sometimes, you know, they're elected for, you know, broader symbolic, you know, political reasons, and sometimes rectors are elected because they're more a working rector. Whereas the senior governor, you know, we shouldn't forget, is a very powerful position. They have that overall responsibility for leadership and good governance of the court. They have responsibilities to ensure, as intimated, that, you know, members, you know, work together. They are that critical friend of the principal and the senior team without getting involved in operational matters. You know, they ensure that the institution is, you know, well connected to other networks. They will have ex officio roles quite often on policy and resources committees. They will make a significant contribution in areas like remuneration, and as I said earlier, you know, they're, you know, involved in the performance appraisal of principals. So, you know, rectors, you know, don't have that role of, you know, really overseeing the governance You know, so chairs of court have very...
For 1 minute.
I know you're not, but the point
the rectors should be covered policy, a chair of the court on matters of policy, and that there should be a co-chair, not elected by the governing body. Can you give me an example where a chairman of a large association has been elected and where it's been successful?
I don't believe universities should necessarily be compared to a business. It's a very important. They have many business-like, you know, considerations, but they're an academic institution that is there, you know, for the good of their students. They are indeed a pillar of our economy and are a pillar of wider society. You know, I'm not sure. While there are some parallels, I'm not sure that I direct contrast with the world of business.
I didn't say that. I said association.
Necessary. Well, you know, but you know, I think in recognising, in accordance with the von Pranzinski review, that the senior governor, stroke convener, chair of court, is a hugely powerful and influential position, and the position of this government believes that that should be an elected position to reflect every voice on campus and that wider view of university life.
Thank you. Did you want a question, Mr. Pentland?
Yeah, very quickly. Obviously, as you would appreciate, Cabinet Secretary, I mean, as a committee, we're trying to understand, you know, the role of the rector with that of the appointed chair. And I think previously, Scottish Government officials were kind of unable to explain that point, as was the committee trying to establish a clear understanding of what that role should be. And I think it may have been a wee bit remiss for the committee, you know, to be maybe ask the rectors along for, you know, for an evidence session to perhaps talk about that. But, you know, you've...
Excuse me for a second, Cabinet Secretary. The committee discussed this matter and took the view about who wanted along as witnesses. We collectively decided that to who the witnesses would be.
Yeah, but I'm also of the opinion, Chair, without going into detail, that I think it may have been an opportunity missed to fully understand what the rector's view was. But I think to go back to some of your answers to Chick Brody with regards to how can you sort of confirm with us that, you know, that this relationship, you know, will come together and they will be able to deliver a service, because when you start thinking about some of the past rectors who've expressed some concern to committee that they feel that their role may be diminished. And I have this concern, I'm sure along with others, that, you know, it will take quite a while for this relationship to come together.
I mean, I think I'm on record, in various places in terms of the press, correspondence to this committee, and, you know, indeed Parliament, you know, when I say that we have no intention of abolishing the role of rector, and that, you know, I would seek to minimise or remove any impact on the traditional and valuable role of rector as it stands. I suppose the first thing we have to do, and I suppose we do it in tandem, is I've referred to that ongoing work of, you know, working with all interested parties in the sector about, you know, the process of electing chairs. And as part of that work, you know, we will consider the detail of rectors. But there's no desire to change the role of rector. There are complexities to, you know, consider. You know, rectors and the ancients have, you know, the statutory right to chair court. You know, I have no desire, you know, to change that, but we need to look at how that would, you know, interact with provision for elected chairs across the sector. And that's the sort of detail that we're in the midst of, you know, working out with all parties. But as I've said previously, you know, we're not abolishing rectors, and I would seek to, you know, minimise or remove any, you know, unintended impact on the existing role of rectors.
You're on record saying that you believe that diversity within the sector is one of the greatest assets of our universities. I wonder, in relation to this point that we're just discussing, could you tell us what you think the model of governance might be as a result of the bill with someone like the Royal Conservatoire, which is a very small institution, highly specialist, very effective, and they made the point at the round table that they fear for some aspects of this bill that could condition them into a sort of single model of governance that doesn't actually suit their kind of institution. Could you comment on that?
I mean, I'm very conscious that the sector is diverse, as you say, Ms. Smith. You know, you have the Royal Conservatoire, a very small specialist institution. You know, compare that with, you know, a larger ancient, you know, university. But what this bill seeks to do, yes, it is seeking to introduce a level of consistency in some quite discrete areas of governance. How we get that balance right in terms of a level of consistency, you know, in the context of a sector that is quite diverse, is indeed, you know, subject to the ongoing discussions that we're having in and around the process of how you elect a chair. But I don't think it's unreasonable to expect some level of consistency. But we'll work.
I think the point they're making, as are other universities, that in Section 4 of the bill, mm-hmm. That there could arise a situation where some existing members of governing councils would actually effectively have to demit office in order to allow new proposals to take shape. Are you comfortable with that, bringing the expertise that they have, particularly in a small institution, are you comfortable with that?
Well, I think, to be clear, the code states that the size of university court is at 25. My understanding is that that's not fixed, and indeed the chairs of court have began to lay out some of their thoughts about, you know, in the fullness of time, how they'll review the code. And bearing in mind that university courts are currently at 25, Section 4 is looking to prescribe 8 members of that in terms of 2 trade unions, 2 members of staff, 2 students and 2 alumni. So that's 8 out of 25. The majority of institutions would probably already have.
Now, my point is, Cabinet Secretary, that to take Section 4 to its full impact, some existing members would actually have to come off the Governing Council. Are you comfortable with that?
Yeah, but we've also said that in terms of the implementation of the bill, it would be implemented over a period of time, a period of 4 years. So I don't think we're in the business of, you know, cack-handedly removing.
But it is back to the original situation where the government is actually insisting on specific categories within governance. And that's the point that's causing the concern. It doesn't matter which side of the debate you're on, that's the aspect that's causing concern, particularly for, as I say, institutions like Glasgow School of Art, Rural College, and the Royal Conservatoire, are much smaller and much more specialist in their input. It's whether one type of governance is actually meeting the diversity of our institutions.
But Section 4 deals with 8 members out of, you know, a court, a university court of 25, and, you know, the bill will be implemented over a period of time.
George Adams. Yes, thanks, Convener. On the back of that, Cabinet Secretary, I'd like to talk about governing body representation. We've had the debate recently in the Chamber and also evidence to this committee, and one of the things that came strongly from the NUS in particular was that under the current conditions, they feel that many of the decisions that, when they are involved, many of the decisions are actually made with regard to remuneration and capital plans before they actually get an opportunity to engage with it. Now, would you say, obviously, if we're going to open up this to a more democratic representation like trade unions and the NUS and the college and university union as well, how will this ensure that we actually have a better democratic representation? How will it lead to better governance?
I believe that members of staff, trade unionists, students, are well capable of taking part and making a contribution to the big strategic decisions that a university governing body has to continue with. And, you know, as with other parts of the bill, we're looking at greater participation of a wider range of voices within the decision making that takes place within an institution. And, you know, in terms of better governance, I think by definition and outcome, you know, that broader, more inclusive approach that includes, you know, a range of voices, all voices in campus, can only be a good thing that is positive in helping the sector move forward.
Yeah, Cabinet Secretary, because this is purely my own personal view as well. As one of the things I see as a positive from this is the fact that you do have that diverse grouping there who have the interest of the institution that they're a part of at the heart of it as well. And that's some of the things that are coming from the institutions themselves. They're almost saying that some of the trade union groups may not have that interest, and I don't believe that's the case. Personally, I believe that, you know, that it's a case of collective responsibility and everybody working together to make sure that their institution can be that modern, inclusive institution that we all want it to be. Now, do you see that, because you said you want to have a more modern and transparent form of governance in your opening statements, does this not obviously give us, yes, it may be more difficult for universities to manage the situation, but is this not just a more modern way for us, as you said earlier on, for us to work and be able to show that our universities can take that next leap, that next step into the 21st century?
I don't see diversity and the inclusion of representatives from staff, trade unions, students as counterproductive to collective responsibility. This government commissioned a body of work, which I'm familiar with due to my previous portfolio, in terms of the Working Together review. That work was led by Jim Mather, the former Enterprise Minister, and Graeme Smith from the STUC, that was essentially looking at the value of social partnership and, you know, including voices. This is obviously in the context of, you know, the world of work, strictly as we understand it. But, you know, part of that body of evidence looked at examples of, for example, NHS Lothian, where on their board they have a director of employee relations, which is the most senior person in the trade union in NHS Lothian, and they obviously have a role and responsibility to represent the interests of their members. But, you know, that you know, director of employee relations that, you know, sits on the board of NHS Lothian, you know, quite clearly, you know, has a responsibility for good governance and, you know, the overall collegiality and collective responsibility of the board also.
Can I also just ask another point on, Elizabeth asked about, she mentioned the Royal Conservatoire as an example, and it is obviously a smaller institution compared to the rest, as we've all agreed on the scenario. But one of the scenarios that they find that is quite difficult was the fact that they don't have trade union representation as such within their institution. And that was part of the issue for them, if there was a kind of way of going down the having to have trade union representation within their board. Now, I don't know if that's... I don't know the inner workings of the Royal Conservatoire, but that to me seems that maybe there might be a case to be made for certain institutions like that have a different makeup of looking, being a wee more flexible.
I mean, that certainly sounds like an unusual situation, which, you know, we'll examine closely. I mean, there are all sorts of differences and diversity, you know, from institution to institution. I mean, we're not demurring from that fact. But we do need to get that balance correct in terms of a level of consistency in some, you know, discrete areas of governance in terms of some of the things that we believe are fundamental, but also, you know, recognising that different institutions, you know, have, you know, different complexities in their makeup.
I just want to clarify something. Sorry, George, have you finished there?
Yes.
Yeah, thank you. I just want to clarify a couple of points. You've just gone through, Mr. Adam.
you said, I think, in response to his first question, that one of the reasons for this was to have a wider range of voices on the governing bodies of higher education institutions. But I'm sure you accept that all of the governing bodies at the moment have staff representatives on them, and approximately 70% of the governing bodies currently have student representatives on them. So I'm just wondering, you know, how you would define getting a wider range of bodies, given they all have staff representatives and 70% of them currently have student representatives.
Yeah, I mean, as I said in my earlier answer, I can't remember if it's to Mr. Adam or to Ms. Smith, that the majority of institutions would have four out of the eight places that the legislation seeks to implement. So we're not saying that institutions haven't made progress or they're not halfway there or, you know, in the case of some institutions, you know, almost there. But it is, you know, I believe, important that the rights of staff, students and trade unions, that should be reflected in the bill and in terms of the work that flowed from the Von Prunzinski review.
You've also made it clear your desire to have union representatives on the governing bodies as well. I just want to make clear, and I suppose it's in a follow-up again to Mr. Adam, about in a situation where a trade union or trade unions represent either a relatively small number, perhaps less than half, perhaps quite a small minority of the staff, is it reasonable for a trade union representative to be the staff representative, or is it more reasonable to have some other staff representative to be representative of all the staff rather than somebody from a trade union?
I mean, as the bill stands, I mean, it has made provision for both staff representatives and trade union representatives. So, you know, we recognise that, you know, a different proportion of, you know, the workforce in different institutions, you know, will be unionised. But, you know, we're talking about two places for trade union members out of a quote of 25, you know, representing both, you know, academic and, you know, non-academic staff.
Liz Smith.
Just a very quick point. I have a letter here from a union representative in the Royal Conservatoire speaking on behalf of members. He makes the point that one of the aspects that Section 4 in the bill would change by insisting that there were a union representative on it is that other members on that board who are actually elected by staff, may I say, would actually no longer be there. And he's pointing to the fact that their expertise is essential when it comes to the way in which the Royal Conservatoire operates. He's very clear in his letter that he feels that they have a very good relationship. He feels that unions are very much involved in what's going on. And he's again pointing to the fact that, you know, it would be preferable if there wasn't one model of governance, because this is working for the Royal Conservatoire and unions are fully involved in that process. Indeed, I think that was a comment that the principal made when he came to the round table. So would you consider having some options and different roles, models of governance as you go towards stage one debate?
I mean, there is, you know, a broader consideration with regards to all the details as we move forward to the stage one debate and indeed stage two of proceedings. And, you know, the point that Ms. Smith makes is that there are shades of opinions within all stakeholders. So I can point to shades of opinions within senior managers, principals, and similarly, either shades of opinions within, you know, trade union representatives and students. And what we're working hard to do as a government is to bring as much of that, of those diverse, at times diverse, range of opinions together, you know, in an effort to co-design and, you know, reach a position of consensus on, you know, a range of issues. But as I said earlier, I mean, the bill, you know, won't pass one day in Parliament and then be, you know, introduced or implemented in practice the following day. You know, there is quite a lengthy period of transition.
Thanks, Chris. Just to ask about academic boards and to ask why the government feel that the size of those boards is a matter for government intervention.
I mean, this flows from the recommendations in the von Prusinski review. That's where the figure of having academic boards or senates of no larger than 120. And, you know, when we looked at, you know, what proportion of the academic boards should be made up of students, what von Prusinski recommended was a substantial proportion. And, you know, we considered that 10% was a substantial proportion and a reasonable proportion. Other people may have some views about whether, you know, 10% is exactly the right figure as well.
Okay. The committee have asked before why students are specifically mentioned in that 10% figure that you quoted, and staff and trade unions went, and the government response were that by having an inclusive and fair governing body would permeate throughout the institution, therefore there's no need to stipulate that there must be union or alumni representation on the academic board. Can you tell me why there was that 10% threshold for students specified, given that statement, and that alumni and staff weren't covered?
I mean, the quote that Mr. Griffin read out would be our, you know, current position, that in terms of, you know, academic boards where, you know, academics you know, are largely represented, but in line with von Prusinski, we've opted to include 10% of student representation, and we didn't feel it was necessary to stipulate that trade unions or alumni should be represented within the academic boards, given that the university court is the main governing body where, you know, everybody is represented, and that the range of voices included in the university court will of course have a flow through into other areas of university life. I mean, we haven't changed our position on that matter. So, you know, students, trade unions, alumni, staff represented in university court, but our position is still that you know, the academic board is for academics and students.
Okay. We've heard already concerns about how the diverse range of institutions are covered by issues relating to the governing body, and I think those concerns exist as well relating to the academic board, and particularly the 120 member threshold. Just to ask how and if you'd respond to those specific concerns about that threshold, given the very diverse nature of the sector. I'm thinking Edinburgh University in particular.
Yeah, I mean, certainly, I mean, most institutions would have an academic board, you know, of around 120. There are larger institutions that have much larger academic boards, you know, academic boards that are, you know, often, or, you know, if you look at Edinburgh, I think bigger than the House of Commons in terms of the number of MPs, and certainly, you know, much larger and representatives than this Parliament. Again, I mean, it flows from the von Prusinski review. They had, you know, received, you know, evidence about, you know, the size of academic boards, and how, you know, if a body was too large, how that could lead to, you know, less than satisfactory arrangements. And I can't remember whether it was in the actual report or evidence that this committee received, but there were some concerns about, you know, boards being dysfunctional, you know, in and around the size of them.
Okay. Finally, the last question, just to ask how you think the changes that the bill is proposing will make sure that academic boards are performing effectively and are representative in their decision making, and where the deficiencies are at the moment that we're looking to address?
I mean, again, in terms of the implementation of good governance and all aspects of good governance, that will be for universities in the sector to pursue. I mean, overall, what this bill is aiming to do is to set a framework and to make some changes in quite discrete areas of university governance. And as I said earlier, in terms of how all of that is implemented, how it is monitored, evaluated, how we reflect upon progress that is made post the bill, you know, that is work that we'll undertake to do in a very detailed manner with all stakeholders in the sector.
Okay, thank you. On this question of the size of academic boards, when officials came before the committee and we were talking about this issue, they said the figure of 120 comes from the review, that's the von Bronczynski review, which is the substantive evidence base that largely inspired all the provisions in the bill, and then also said in, at the same time, it would not have been arrived at willy-nilly. I imagine it was the subject of lots of cross-sectoral dialogue and that many opinions were taken. Now, as far as I'm aware, and I could be wrong here, but as far as I'm aware, I can't find it in the von Bronczynski report. It may be in an annex, it may be in some other evidence, let's call it unspecified evidence. I'm just wondering if you could give us some detail of how we got from this position of what it said in von Bronczynski, and as I say, I don't know what the evidence is because I couldn't find it, and it being in the bill that there should be a maximum of 120.
Yeah, I mean, my understanding of von Bronczynski was that the recommendation was overall academic boards should not normally have more than 120 members. I'll have a look to see whether that's in the body of the report, an annex, or an actual recommendation. But can you cast any light on that just now, Stephen?
I'm pretty certain it's a recommendation, but in terms of a supporting rationale and detail, I don't think the report has published featured that for all the workings, if you like, for all the recommendations. But we can certainly take that up in detail, take it up with the author, I suppose, as well.
No, that's what I'm asking, Mr. White, because clearly it did say that. I accept that's what it said, but I don't know why it said that. It's a statement without evidence, as far as I can see, and there may well be evidence, and I'm sure there is evidence, but it would be helpful if we could find out what that is.
We can take that up, yes.
Thank you very much. Liz Smith?
On that point, Convener, it would also be very helpful if we could get some evidence as to why the von Bronczynski review said that it heard an unspecified evidence which points towards dysfunctionality when the membership of the academic board is too large. Where's the evidence for the dysfunctionality?
We'll pursue that as well, Convener.
Yep. I'm very grateful for that. Thank you very much. Can I turn our attention just now to the section of the bill which hasn't actually had a lot of attention outside because of other matters, but it's the issue, I think, a very important issue of academic freedom. Now, I did ask at least some questions in the debate we had recently and also in when the officials were before us. So I want to cover some points, some general points and some specific points about this. Obviously, there was a range of evidence submitted to us about the issue of redefining, or maybe updating is a better word, the definition of academic freedom. Could you talk us through why you thought that was necessary?
I think it's fair to say, Convener, that the adjustments to the existing definition of academic freedom are modest, and I think it's only, you know, right and proper that we acknowledge that this isn't, you know, a huge radical departure or a huge radical change. They're modest adjustments in terms that instead of institutions having regard to academic freedom, that they must aim to uphold academic freedom. And it includes, the definition now includes explicitly, whereas I think it was implicitly implied that that it includes freedom to develop and advance new ideas.
Given we've just been speaking about the bill, or much of it coming from the von Bronczynski review, again, that review, as far as I can see, didn't highlight any particular problems with the existing definition of academic freedom which set out in the 2005 Act. Again, I accept, of course, this is where it comes from, the von Brunzinski review. But again, I'm asking the question, where is the evidence for a problem with the current definition as laid out in the 2005 Act that required this change as laid out in the current bill?
I mean, again, I mean, I don't think, I mean, speaking from the government's perspective, that we were coming from the premise of deficiency, you know, looking at the recommendations of the von Brunzinski review, you know, there was an opportunity to, you know, make modest adjustments or improvements to the definition of academic freedom. I appreciate that there are, again, a range of views about the value of these modest deficiencies as well.
Yeah, I'm interested by your comments, Cabinet Secretary, about how modest the change is. And again, I'm wondering whether or not, given it's so modest, whether it's required. But can I move on to a more specific question about it, which is, effectively, this has been submitted to us, that the alteration to the definition of academic freedom might change the nature of some internal disputes within higher and education institutions. And I think there's a specific question I want to ask, which has come specifically, I suppose, from the SCOGEC submission to the committee, which was very detailed on this particular area of the bill. And I met with Representative SCOGEC last week to discuss this, and they certainly have concerns about what might be called the imbalance of freedoms here. They were keen to point out that the Higher Education Code of Governance specifically talked about the freedoms and academic freedoms of staff and lecturers, etc., but also balanced that with the rights of students and other members of staff in the institution. But also were keen to point out that the bill itself, in making this adjustment, had no balancing rights effectively referred to on the face of the bill. Now, I just wondered what your view was of the SCOGEC evidence. I'm sure you've had an opportunity to look at it and ask the question to you, why is there no balancing of rights contained within the bill, but it is within the Code of Governance?
Yeah, I mean, we'll certainly look at in detail the concerns of SCOGEC. I mean, there was certainly a commitment given by ministers to yourself, convener, to meet in relation to explaining matters further or indeed resolving any concerns. I'm certainly alive to the issues raised by SCOGEC, and my official Stephen White has certainly met with them. Maybe it'd be helpful if Stephen could speak about his meeting.
Yeah, I met with Mr. Ephraim Borowski and colleagues from SCOGEC, and they talked me through their evidence, and I emailed the clerks, and I think the main action point was on this question of balance. What I said I would specifically do was go back and investigate the 2005 Act's construction and the standing definition, and from doing that, to establish what consideration, if any, was given to the student side of the equation. We're going through that process. I suppose, in looking at the code in comparison here, the code has a broader role than setting a legal definition of freedom for an academic. But what I want to establish is, why was it so specifically drafted, and what's the origins of that, and what the debate was at the time? So I've undertaken to do that, and to get back to colleagues at SCOGEC.
Well, that's very welcome. But I suppose in the modesty of the change is effectively to now must uphold. And clearly there is concern from SCOGEC and some others that, and I'm sure you may be aware of a number of incidents that I will not repeat in public session, particularly with Jewish students around the country, where there is concern, and I have to say I share their concerns, that academic freedom has been used as a cover for, let's say, actions that have been taken against individual students. And then if you move from the current definition, which we're operating under at the moment, where some of these things have happened, to a definition which says must uphold academic freedom, that may in fact strengthen the hand of some individuals who frankly behave out with, I think, the norms of what we'd expect academic staff to behave.
Yeah. And I mean, again, Convener, I'll be very careful in my response to you, given that we are in public session. But, you know, there is clarity that whether it's the current definition of academic freedom or indeed this modest proposed change to academic freedom, that that does not excuse people from operating within current law. There is, you know, a wide range of legislation in terms of, you know, matters of incitement, discrimination, and, you know, there is nothing in the current or proposed definition that would excuse people from their obligations to existing legislation. I can ask Ailsa maybe to give you a legal perspective on that, if that would be
absolutely
helpful.
That would be helpful, but I mean, I have to say that you obviously, I accept completely what you've said about the law, but there is an issue about if you strengthen the wording as suggested to uphold, then the certainly that has raised additional concerns about the risks that we, I think, both understand.
Okay, and it's those concerns that we would seek to alleviate.
Okay, thank you. Ailsa.
I think, I'll just say, first of all, you know, the strengthened provision, it says must aim to uphold, so it's not must uphold. I mean, there is, I would say, that is slightly weaker than must uphold, must aim to uphold.
But
so
it's a change from the current definition.
So I agree, it's a change from the current definition. But in, as the Cabinet Secretary has said, academic freedom is not unlimited. It does not excuse people from complying with other provisions of the law, whether that's criminal law, laws on defamation, obscenity, whatever. That the academic freedom is not unlimited. And that will not change.
No, I accept that. I accept that. Thank you for that. Mary, I think you wanted a question.
Yes, Convener. As we all know, it's... the small words here and there that make all the difference to how legislation is understood and implemented. And we've passed plenty of legislation in this Parliament, and when it was implemented, it certainly wasn't always what we understood it to be. So what I'm really asking is what new responsibilities this modest change, as it's described, what new responsibilities would it impose on governing bodies? And I ask that really because of the concern that, again, Dame Jocelyn Bell raised, that there was a view that this legislation would lead to a suppression of critical thought. But if you could just be precise about what responsibilities it does or doesn't impose on governing bodies.
Well, I mean, I don't think there's anything in this legislation or indeed in and around these modest adjustments to academic freedom that is going to suppress thought. But I mean, in terms of, you know, new responsibilities in and around academic freedom, I mean, institutions, you know, already have to uphold existing responsibilities. So again, I think it'd be quite disingenuous for me to suggest that I could produce a list of new responsibilities or any, you know, onerous new responsibilities that this would place on institutions. I mean, it's part of their day-to-day business to refine what they do, you know, in response to their understanding of academic freedom. I mean, I do stress these are modest and I think quite subtle changes.
Well, I think just another point, Convener. The University of St Andrews has asked how the wording must aim to uphold would accord with separate statutory duties placed on universities, for example, Section 26(1) of the Counter-Terrorism and Security Act, for example, imposes a statutory duty on higher education bodies to have due regard to the need to prevent people from being drawn into terrorism. So have you looked at this proposed legislation in terms of what's already in place and how they both join together?
Yes, but I mean, I think in terms of, you know, answering specific points about counter-terrorism legislation and the how that coexists with the definition of academic freedom. And I'll ask Ailsa to respond, but if there are outstanding issues in and around quite a detailed area, we will get back to committee.
I'm happy to answer the question. In terms of the section referred to in the Counter-Terrorism Act, it applies to specified bodies, and my understanding is at the moment it doesn't apply to any Scottish specified bodies. that, but Scottish bodies can be added to the list, so that doesn't, so it may apply in future. But there is specific provision made for English universities in the in that Act in Section 31, and when they are carrying out their duty to not to prevent people being drawn into to terrorism, then they must have regard to the importance of academic freedom. So there's specific provision already in that bill for the balancing of these two duties. So, as I say, at the moment, my understanding is it doesn't apply to Scottish universities. They're not listed as specified authorities at the moment who are subject to this duty. If they were to be listed, then probably there'd have to be some provision that has been made in a similar way to the, what applies to the English universities, because there's a specific reference to the definition of academic freedom as it applies in England.
Given that the University of St Andrews have raised this issue, convener, I wonder if I could ask the bill team if it's something they might like to discuss with them prior to the bill going forward.
Of course.
Liz Smith, quick supplementary.
One question, Cabinet Secretary. When the bill says that there will be freedom within the law to develop and advance new ideas or innovative proposals, is there something wrong in the present structure that universities don't have new ideas and innovative proposals?
No, but convener, I refer to earlier answer. I mean, these are modest changes, and people, will be.
Why do we need them?
Free. Well, that will be a point that people are very free to debate.
Mark Griffin.
Thanks, Kevina. I just have a couple of questions around the financial memorandum, questions that have been raised through the Finance Committee scrutiny. And the first one was that in standing orders, the government is required to set out the best estimates of the administrative compliance and other costs to which the provision of the bill would give rise to. Just to ask why then there is nothing in the financial memorandum around the estimated costs to higher education institutes of amending their governing instruments.
Because, it's part of the core business of a university and their court to be, amending their, existing instruments and arrangements. I mean, committee will be, familiar with the process, in and around the Privy Council, whereby universities, make their proposals. The Scottish University Committee, as it's known, which is, the First Minister, Lord Advocate, Lord President, their views are consulted before, matters of changes in and around articles goes to the Privy Council. So, I mean, I just say that by way of demonstrating that, universities do this sort of work all the time, and, I wouldn't anticipate, significant new costs, in and around what Mr. Griffin describes in the bill.
I appreciate that they may do this on a regular basis, but they do that on the basis of decisions they take themselves, whereas in this instance they'll be incurring these costs as a result of action taken by the government. And this is something the Finance Committee have raised in the report and asked why, because they haven't incurred those costs as a result of a decision of government, why that hasn't been included in the financial memorandum.
Yeah, and I mean, in addition to what I've said previously, convener, we have, in response to the issues raised by Finance Committee, said that, we will give consideration to provide an updated financial memorandum at stage two, and we are, of course, looking at the detail of the constructive comments raised by Finance Committee. It doesn't change, our current view that we don't see, substantial costs arising as a result of this bill, but we'll look at the detail of what Finance Committee have submitted to the government, and if we need to refine our thinking or the information in the financial memorandum, we certainly will.
Okay, the other area of the Finance Committee had raised, and I take on board your comments that you will look to refine the financial memorandum, was a discrepancy in evidence that they had received from the government and higher education institutions and Universities Scotland around the financial costs of recruiting a chair of the governing body, around the estimates of a time commitment required by university chairs and how that would impact on the cost. So I'd be grateful if, again, Cabinet Secretary, if you commit to looking at that evidence and include that in any review of the financial memorandum.
Yeah, I mean, and I have said that we'd refine the financial memorandum at stage two if required. I mean, understandably, where there are differences of opinions with regards to the impact of the bill, that will, of course, lead to differences of opinions of, you know, financial repercussions. So, you know, I mean, in that spirit of openness and collegiality, I mean, we, you know, are currently, you know, looking at all the detail of that, you know, to ensure that our position is, you know, absolutely reflective of the reality on the ground.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. On behalf of the committee, Cabinet Secretary, can I thank you and your officials for coming along this morning to give evidence on the Higher Education Scotland Bill. Just for everybody's information, we do intend to publish our Stage 1 report towards the end of this year. And I'm sure that will be an exciting discussion for us all in terms of getting our Stage 1 report together. But can I suspend briefly? Our next item is to take evidence on subordinate legislation as listed on the agenda. Can I welcome Diane Machin, Disclosure Scotland, and Ailsa, is it Heine? Heine from the Scottish Government. Can I obviously begin by inviting brief opening remarks from Diane, I think it is.
Yes, good morning, only just. Thank you for inviting me and my colleague Ailsa from SGLD to attend this committee here and to answer your questions. Questions about the Police Act 1997 and the Protection of Vulnerable Groups Scotland Act 2007, Remedial Order 2015, which amends the system of higher level disclosures in Scotland. With your agreement, I would like to provide you with a brief background to higher level disclosures and why these amendments to the disclosure system in Scotland were needed. Higher level disclosure is the phrase used to describe the overall system that allows for additional scrutiny of a person's criminal convictions. It includes the Protection of Vulnerable Groups scheme, known as the PVG scheme, enhanced disclosures and standard disclosures. These are used where an individual wants to work with vulnerable groups, such as, for example, in a nursery or as a medical professional or in a school, or where someone wants to work in a sensitive area, such as providing financial advice. The changes made on the 10th of September affect only the regime of higher level disclosure and have no impact at all on basic disclosures. In June 2014, the UK Supreme Court found that the system of higher level disclosures, as it operated in England and Wales, breached a person's Article 8 rights under the European Convention of Human Rights. The court fully accepted the need for additional scrutiny of a person's background if they wanted to work with vulnerable groups or in other sensitive roles, but it held that the automatic indiscriminate requirement for disclosure of all spent convictions was not proportionate, as no assessment of the relevance of the information to the need for the disclosure was undertaken. It was suggested by the court that a proportionate system of disclosure should take into account factors such as the age of the conviction, the nature of the offence, the age of the offender, and the relevance of the conviction to the role sought. So this amended system of higher level disclosure takes account of these factors. It restricts the requirement for disclosure so that not all spent convictions will require to be routinely disclosed. Under the amended system, certain spent convictions become protected convictions, and these protected convictions, along with spent cautions, are not required to be disclosed by an individual, nor are they disclosed by the state on a higher level certificate. These convictions are for offences that are deemed to be of a minor nature, where disclosure, once the conviction is spent, would be disproportionate. To ensure the right balance is struck between protecting privacy and safeguarding, there is a prescribed list of offences in the Remedial Order which are deemed so serious that they must always be disclosed, even when spent. Murder is not included on this list because a conviction for murder can never become spent and will therefore always be subject to disclosure. There's a further list of convictions specified in the legislation that are eligible for disclosure on higher level disclosures if prescribed rules are satisfied. The rules cover pertinent factors such as the length of time since conviction, the age of the offender at the time of conviction, and the sentence received in determining whether disclosure should take place. These rules are clear-cut and they're set out in statute. There is no discretion for officials. Ministers intend the focus to remain on enabling a system of robust disclosure checking for roles that involve access to vulnerable groups. They recognise that this safeguarding purpose must be balanced with appropriate protection of rights to privacy and indeed for ex-offenders to be permitted to move on from a past criminal background. We believe that the amended system of higher level disclosure brought into effect by the 2015 Remedial Order strikes this balance. So we would be happy to answer any questions that you have.
Thank you very much. Questions from members? Mary.
Yes. I was quite surprised to read that it's not currently possible for an individual to obtain their own disclosure and barring service disclosure certificate in advance of applying for employment or volunteering. Is there anything in this legislation that would make that easier? Because I just think it might discourage many people coming forward as volunteers, you know, and people knowing about convictions of 10 or 20 years ago. But is there anything happening that would enable an individual to be able to obtain their own disclosure information?
The PVG scheme under which disclosures are sought is a scheme for employers to seek disclosures from people. So there are no rules within that scheme that allow an individual to apply for their own disclosure. We would be disclosing information to people that they already know. And so the purpose of the scheme is to allow for...
Just convener, with due respect, they may not already know. It may be that, you know, the conviction is so long ago or whatever, that they may be eligible to, you know, to apply to do some volunteering work. So with the changes, is it something that's been discussed before? Is it only for... I just think, you know, as an individual, it would be quite embarrassing that the only way you can find out whether or not you have a clean disclosure is for an employer to find out for you. I just feel it might be helpful for an individual to apply. I wonder if that's something that's been discussed in the past, or if it's something that you may consider adding to this legislation.
I think maybe if I can just add to it. Trying to explain, there are two systems of disclosure. There's the system that exists under the Rehabilitation of Offenders legislation, which is about self-disclosure, and that has existed since 1974. People are required to disclose their unspent convictions, and in certain circumstances required to disclose their spent convictions. The disclosure legislation sits basically below that. That's the Police Act and the Protection of Vulnerable Groups Act, to allow employers, put simply, to verify the information that people are giving them under the Rehabilitation of Offenders Act. So a person is expected, in terms of the Rehabilitation of Offenders legislation, to know what convictions they have and to disclose those to an employer. That has been slightly modified in the context of this legislation, in that people are not required to disclose the offences on the rules list, which will only be disclosed for 15 years until they see the disclosure, until the disclosure is given to the employer. But in terms of all other convictions, the Rehabilitation of Offenders Act is what requires people to self-disclose and to know their own convictions. And as Diane said, this is not about telling people what their convictions are. This is, people have to know that already. This is about giving employers the opportunity to verify information and to seek a disclosure from an official source of that information. And it's not about helping people to get access to their own information.
I do understand all that, Convener, but I just wonder if you understand the point that I'm making. You know, if I was an ex-criminal, I might be too embarrassed to go along and apply for volunteering or other jobs, because it would mean that other people might know something about me that I didn't want them to know. And, you know, it is difficult to get volunteers right across Scotland, so I'm just looking at it from the individual's point of view. Just my second point, Convener, is we have a paper from an organisation called Unlock for people with convictions, and I was slightly surprised that the disclosure time periods in England and Wales for a conviction to become protected is 11 years as an adult and 5.5 years for under 18. But my understanding is that in Scotland, instead of 11 years, it will be 15, and the 5.5 for under 18s will be 7.5. I just wonder, they say it's unclear how these periods have been arrived at. I wonder if you could explain or clarify that.
Yes, the disclosure periods of 15 and 7.5 years have been derived within the context of the current rehabilitation periods under the Rehabilitation of Offenders Act, and also the period of time that Police Scotland retain criminal history information on the criminal history system. The periods aim to strike an appropriate balance between the rights of individuals and the rights of those that they are seeking to work with. So under the terms of the Rehabilitation of Offenders Act, the longest period that must pass before a person can become rehabilitated is 10 years. So therefore, it there would be no point in selecting a disclosure period of 10 years or less, because that would render the provision relating to spent convictions for offences on the rules list absolutely meaningless. So we had to select something more than 10 years. We then looked at the CHS weeding rules. The Police Scotland apply a 30-70 rule, which requires a conviction to have been on a person's criminal record for 30 years and for the person to have attained 70 years of age before it will be weeded from their criminal record. So recognising the fact that disclosure under the PVG Act and under the Police Act is for the more limited purpose of employment purposes, we opted for a disclosure period of 15 years for adults and 7.5 years for young people. We do recognise
comparison between Scotland and England. Well, that was the only thing I wasn't didn't understand.
We do recognise that that is different to the period in England and Wales. However, there are a number of differences between the scheme in place in Scotland and the scheme in place in England and Wales. In particular, in Scotland, we have taken an approach that allows each conviction, where somebody has multiple convictions on their record, we have introduced a system where each individual conviction will be considered on its own merits, and the fact that you have a conviction doesn't necessarily hold on another conviction. In England and Wales, if you have more than one conviction, everything is disclosed regardless of how old it is. Likewise, in England and Wales, if you have any conviction that attracts a sentence of imprisonment, everything on the record will be disclosed. In Scotland, we haven't adopted that approach. If you have a conviction that is over 15 years old, that is spent, even though it attracted a period of imprisonment, which it would have to have been a short period of imprisonment. If it's over 15 years old, we won't disclose it if it's on the rules list. So there are differences between other differences between Scotland and England and Wales.
Also, can I just say, in terms of the difference in the actual disclosure period, there is also a difference in the rehabilitation period in England and Wales. So it's not that they're rehabilitation period is 10 years and they've only added on 1.5 years. Their rehabilitation period is less than 10 years, their maximum rehabilitation period. And those differences derive from policy choices made by the UK government and the Scottish government in terms of what they think is an appropriate rehabilitation period. So in England, the conviction is still disclosed for some time after it's spent because of the 11.5 year disclosure period.
Thank you. Chick Rowley.
Thank you. Good afternoon. I'm not sure this is relevant to the legal aspects, but it certainly, in terms of disclosure, depends on databases. But I couldn't find any mention of how we track and therefore be able to disclose those of an international nature, those that have either come to live here. I mean, how are these captured? I mean, I know the suggestion should be they should be on the database, but I don't find anything in the legislation that mentions how we cope with that.
The primary sources of information for criminal record checks are the Scottish Criminal History System and the Police National Computer, which covers the whole of the UK. Disclosure Scotland provide disclosures for people with an address within Scotland. In terms of looking at their overseas convictions, we can access information via police forces, which I think, actually, I don't know how the police forces obtain information.
Yeah, there are ways of accessing information about convictions abroad. Sometimes it is added onto the police databases that are used, particularly the Police National Computer, so the regulations specify which databases Disclosure Scotland use to access the information. And some convictions, foreign convictions, are added to those databases. Otherwise, there are possibilities of making requests to other countries. But in general terms, it's based on the databases and
differences between a request that would be made to another European Union country or a country that's out with the European Union.
Arrangements within the EU.
So if a national from another European Union country who was coming to Scotland to live and work, then that would be relatively straightforward.
the central authority for the EU system is the police authority in England and Wales. So Disclosure Scotland have to liaise with them.
Yes, but there is a process involved within the EU.
Yeah.
Yeah. But if somebody came from out with the EU, it would have to be a direct request to that.
Yeah, I'm not sure. We wouldn't make the direct request in that circumstances for the disclosure, because in terms of the way the legislation is set up, we can only access the information.
Right, well,
that's
who asks for it then?
Nobody asks for the foreign conviction information.
Right. If you have let me just go through this then. If you have somebody who's living in Scotland, resident in Scotland, applies for a job which would require this kind of process to be undertaken, but they resided previously in a country that was out with the EU, how do you get the information? Are you saying you don't get the information?
Disclosure Scotland doesn't request that information. It's not part of the information that is required to be on the certificate.
Right. I want to be absolutely clear we're not making a mistake here, but if it's the case that somebody comes from a non-EU country, perhaps from Eastern Europe or somewhere else, the United States, Canada, Australia, New Zealand, if they come from one of these countries and they live here and work here and they apply for a job which falls under the categories where if it had been a Scottish-born resident, you would have carried out this behaviour, you would have asked for a disclosure check, does that person just not get the job or is it just no check?
Well, they can request a check from Disclosure Scotland.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm.
And the only information that can be provided on the certificate in terms of the legislation is information that appears on the UK databases. That's provided.
No, I understand that. I'm trying to ascertain whether there's any other action taken to try and figure out whether or not an individual is a risk to members of the community in Scotland.
That would be a matter for the employer to consider, and they can...
How would the employer find out whether somebody from Belarus had a serious conviction for sexual assault?
Well, they can ask for, if they're aware that the person has been resident in another country for a long period of time, then they can request that police disclosure from that other country.
The person is under
obligations to, under the Rehabilitation of Offenders legislation, to disclose their convictions.
But we are clear now that somebody from outside the EU, there is no process by which, there's no official process by which the checks would be made in the same way that somebody from within the EU, and particularly from somebody within the UK. It would be up to the employer to write to, who would they write to in Belarus?
It would be for the applicant, they can ask the job applicant to provide a disclosure from whatever police authority or whatever, however it's done in that country.
Right, so they would ask the applicant to provide a disclosure, a similar sort of disclosure check statement from their own country.
They could do, yes. I mean, because the information is not accessible.
No, I understand it's not accessible. I'm just trying to clarify. If they do that and the individual doesn't supply it, or if they don't do that, would it be the case that these individuals would then be barred from employment in these areas, or would they be employed anyway? What's the law here with regard to whether or not an employer could then just take the view that we're not employing you on that basis? We don't have that information.
That would be up to the employer to
No, I'm asking what the legal position is. What's the legal position if somebody fails to provide the information, if it's requested by an employer, about whether or not they have convictions which are relevant and should be disclosed from a country outside the EU?
Well, under the Rehabilitation of Offenders legislation, the person is required to disclose that information, self-disclose that information.
Yes, but
if they fail to do that, then the employer and the employer employs them, then the employer has a potential redress against them if they become aware of that conviction at a later
I'll bring in a second check. If the employer has a potential redress, what we're talking about here is not upsetting an employer,
No. But
surely about the safety of the community involved in, whether it be working with children or working with other vulnerable adults or whatever it happens to be Surely that's what we're talking, not about whether or not we've upset the employer here. I'm trying to understand how you can tell whether or not an individual, let's say it's me, and I've come from this country, from Canada, and I've asked, and I'm asked to fill in the form, and I say zero, and I sign the form. Who's liable if that form is now, you know, if I then go on to carry out an offence against a child or a vulnerable adult or somebody within that employer's premises, is the employer liable? Have they done their job by just accepting the form? What's the position?
Well, the person remains liable under the Rehabilitation of Offenders list for not having disclosed their offences to the employer. And if it's a criminal offence, then obviously they'll be treated under, you know, dealt with under the criminal law.
No, I understand that.
And the employer...
Sorry, I bring in a check.
No, you've just asked a question I wanted to ask. I mean, you will get offenders who probably, you know, in some cases serious offenders, who don't meet the requirements that we stipulated. They will not. It's very unlikely they're going to tell an employer. So the question, which is a relevant one, is the employer employs them, surely they have a liability under what we're trying to do with this legislation.
Well, this legislation doesn't affect the existing position regarding foreign convictions. That position has existed since 1997 when the Police Act was brought in, but that was the first opportunity.
Do you think it should?
I think in terms of the practicalities of a Disclosure Scotland or whatever body in this country trying to access conviction information for the whole world is difficult. I mean, there are reciprocal provisions within the EU so that convictions can be added to the databases, and in terms of if people are barred from working with children in similar ways to the way the PVG scheme works in Scotland, if people are barred in other countries, then Disclosure Scotland is able to make requests to find out that information so that they can consider that information. Those systems are evolving within the EU to try to do that on a
No, I mean, we'll go round and round, but I mean, the convenient point, when a non-EU country has no records, if we face someone in a circumstance who does not meet these disclosure requirements, but of course there's no record, then we are vulnerable, aren't we?
Well, but to an extent, yes. That's a problem that's existed.
It's not a change.
It's not a new problem.
Okay, and that's something I'm sure the committee will discuss afterwards, but can I move back directly to the actual order that we're discussing? My understanding is that prior to the 15-year time period elapsing, an individual can apply to a sheriff for dispensation, if that's the right word, to have the conviction information removed, so they don't have to disclose it. Is that correct?
For an offence that is on the list of offences disclosed subject to rules, yes.
Yes, the 8B, I think.
Yes.
Yes. What's the period before 15 years? Is it any period before within the 15-year period, or is it just... When you're close to the fact, I mean, if it was only 7 years since the offence, or 10 years, or 12 years, or 14 and a half years, is the point at which they cannot apply to have that removed?
No.
So they can apply at any period.
If somebody receives a certificate on which there is a spent conviction for an offence on 8B, they can apply to the sheriff to have that removed, regardless
at
of
any
whether
point.
It's 11 years old or 14
right.
years.
Right, there's no restriction on that. They can no apply to a sheriff at any point within that 15-year period.
Yes, but they have to be able to show a good reason why that information should be removed.
Okay, I understand that. And my second question is with regard to, could you perhaps explain how we came up with the lists that are on 8A versus 8B, and where the line is drawn and why it's drawn. I look, for example, in some of the notes that have been supplied, examples of serious offences that will always be disclosed include rape, for example. And I look at 8A and it has a list of offences, including statutory offence of rape, assault with intent to rape or ravish, bestiality. What about other serious sexual assaults and offences? Where is the line drawn between a sexual offence, for example, could be one of the other offences, but I'm asking about a sexual offence, that puts it on 8A versus another sexual offence that puts it on 8D?
Almost all of the sexual offences are covered on 8A.
Right. Almost all?
Yes, because there are, as well as the common law offences that are specified at the beginning of Schedule 8A, so the assaults with intent to rape or ravish, yeah, there are also statutory offences which are covered in the sexual offences. So I don't know if you have a copy of the order in front of you, but on page 8, at paragraph 37, a sexual offence within the meaning given by section 210A of the Criminal Procedure Scotland Act, that is a very extensive list of sexual offences. So all of those specified sexual offences are covered under paragraph 37 here, with the exception of sexual offences involving two older children, which we have put onto the rules list to allow for a scenario where, for example, there may be two consenting 17-year-olds.
I understand that provision. That seems reasonable to me. But I want to understand the difference between the extensive list that you've mentioned and which would be fall under 8A, and then the difference on Schedule 8B, where at point 18, public indecency is listed as one of the offences which falls under 8B. Public indecency can be quite a wide spectrum of activity, yes, if I can call it that.
Yes, and considering the offence lists, we looked at a range of criteria that determined what went on which lists. So we looked at whether the offences resulted in serious harm, for example, whether they represented a significant breach of trust, whether they represented dishonesty. There were a range of criteria that we considered. There are a whole number of offences that can cover a very broad spectrum of types of behaviour. Public indecency is one of those. We have taken the view that actually the public indecency offences predominantly tend to be offences at the lower end of the spectrum of seriousness, and that more serious sexual offences tend to be covered under charges of lewd and libidinous practices, which are covered in Schedule A. So we did have to draw a line somewhere in the sand. We have recognised in drawing that line that we have to take account of the sentence imposed by the court when they have convicted somebody. And for any of these offences on either of the lists, the severity of the sentence is a reflection of the seriousness of the offence. And so somebody may have been convicted of a public indecency offence if the nature of that specific act was very serious, then they will have received a serious sentence for that, which may in fact remove them from the realm of the conviction becoming spent at all. So even though it is on Schedule 8B, it may continue to always be disclosed if the severity of the sentence determines that that should be the case.
And would the same argument apply to, for example, again on 8B, you've got things like fraud and embezzlement, etc.?
Yes.
And so the same argument logic would apply for a job,
yes,
if you're applying for the financial sector.
The offence of extortion is on Schedule 8A, mm-hmm, and the offence of fraud is on 8B, and again, that was because fraud can cover an extremely wide range of offending behaviour, from very small frauds to massive frauds. And there was an example just in the media today, in fact, of somebody convicted of an £8 million fraud for which a sentence of 4.5 years was imposed. Now, that will always be disclosed because the sentence determines that it will never be spent.
Thank you very much. Does anybody get any other questions want to raise at this point? No, can I thank you very much for attending this morning. I know that I'm sure members will have a number of issues they want to raise. Can I ask whether, given the evidence we've just received, whether members wish to have a further discussion on this, or do we wish to, for example, write to the Scottish Government to raise some of these questions?
Another opportunity to look at this.
The actual order,
it's January.
Yes, we will. Yes. We will actually be dealing with the order, yes, in the normal fashion, probably early in the new year.
Yes.
I'm asking members whether, given what we have heard today and given what we've received in writing, whether we wish to write to the Scottish Government, for example, or take any other action that you feel is appropriate to find out any further information.
Yeah.
What's your view?
I think the concern that we discussed regarding international, I don't apologise for asking the question, but I think it might be
well to highlight to the government the fact that we did question, you know, the set of circumstances. They may have to go back to Police Scotland or what have you. But I do think it's, yeah, worth asking the question.
Okay. Agreed. Gordon, Mary?
I do appreciate that this legislation is for employers in terms of deciding who to recruit, but I just wonder, as we have the opportunity, if we can ask the government if any consideration has been given to, you know, if a potential volunteer or employee may have access to see what is on the record.
Okay, I think, I mean, we can, what, can I suggest that effectively the clerks draft a letter to the Scottish Government, we'll bring that back to the committee, we can have a discussion in private if members are agreed to that, and then we can decide whether we want to amend that letter or send that letter as is. Is that agreeable?
Great.
Agreed. Thank you very much for that. And can I once again thank the witnesses for coming along this morning. Now move to agenda item 4. The next item is to move a motion on consideration of the Order of the Education Scotland Bill at stage 2. So therefore I wish to move SM414740 that the Education and Culture Committee considers the Education Scotland Bill at stage 2 in the following order: sections 5 to 17, the schedule, sections 1 to 4, sections 18 to 28 and the long title. Do members agree? That's agreed. Thank you very much. The committee has agreed to hold the next item in private, so I therefore now close the meeting to the public.